Hello everyone. So we're starting today with 2.2 on water. Now, this is a fascinating lecture because water is so important to our daily lives. Yet, it is one of the stranger chemicals that we regularly interact with. It has a lot of fun properties. So let's dive right in. First off, you have to know that water molecules are polar and that hydrogen bonds can form between them. Now, water is made up of two hydrogen and one oxygen atom. The oxygen atom is actually a little bit larger, it has more electrons. Because of that, it's more negative, and that's all you need to know. Meanwhile, the hydrogens are more positive because the electrons are closer to the oxygen nuclei. Again, worry about that if you're in chemistry, not biology. What you do need to know is that water is made of two hydrogens and one oxygen, and covalent bonds are formed between them. Because the oxygen is negative and the hydrogen is positive, this molecule is called polar. Now, the negative charge on oxygen is actually attracted to the positive hydrogens of other water molecules. So, the oxygen of one water molecule is attracted to the hydrogen of another one. And the bond that they form between two different water molecules are called hydrogen bonds. And hydrogen bonds can form between water and other molecules, but you really just need to know that they form within water. So do not get covalent and hydrogen bonds confused. Covalent bonds are within one water molecule, where the hydrogens are positive and the oxygen is negative. Hydrogen bonds are between two water molecules because positives are attracted to negatives. So, covalent bonds are between hydrogen and oxygen of one water molecule. Hydrogen bonds are between hydrogen and oxygen of two different water molecules. Make sure not to get that mixed up. Now, water forms hydrogen bonds with other water molecules, and it has the covalent bond within it. Because it has a positive and a negative pole, it is called dipolar. Now, the hydrogen bonding and dipolarity of water give it some really useful properties for life, specifically cohesion and adhesion, as well as thermal and solvent properties. So, you will need to know all of these, and let's dive right in. Thermal means temperature, or heat. And water's interesting relationship with heat is caused by its hydrogen bonds. You have to know this. So the hydrogen bonds between the water molecules mean that water holds on to other water molecules, so it resists change. So it takes a lot of energy to change the temperature of water. Additionally, it takes a lot of energy to boil water. Again, because those water molecules are holding on so tight to each other, boiling only happens when one water molecule leaves. And they're holding on to each other, so it takes a lot of energy to break that hydrogen bond to separate them. For some similar reasons, it actually takes a lot of energy to freeze water. Don't worry as much about that. But the hydrogen bonding in any case is related, and the polarity to water floating. So, let's go through the ones that are a bit more important. Water has a high heat capacity, so it's hard to change the temperature of water. You have to know that. This is super useful for living things. Water makes a great habitat because the change in the temperature of water over a day, from night when it's colder to the day when it's hotter, is very small compared to the air. That's why at the beach, the water always feels freezing during the day, but warm at night. Just because of that difference, the air changes temperature more than the water. Now, this is also useful for living things. Our body is mostly water, and it's hard to change the temperature, which is useful for our enzymes and homeostasis. Water also helps keep us cool. Because it takes so much energy to evaporate water, to boil it, because you need to break all the hydrogen bonds to release those water molecules, it means that water can absorb a lot of energy before evaporating. And that energy is coming from your body heat. So when you get really hot, your body puts the water on the surface of your skin. This water absorbs energy, changing from liquid to gas, breaking the hydrogen bonds, and the fastest or hottest molecules leave first, meaning that the water left behind is cooler, cooling you down. This is super important. If you overheated, the homeostasis of your body would be messed up, and it could damage your enzymes. So both plants transpire and animals sweat to keep our body temperatures more constant. And on top of that, blood can carry temperature heat around your body. Your organs and your muscles are making heat when you use them, and that heat is going to be absorbed by your blood and move to your skin to cool you down. Now, the next big property of water, not thermal, is cohesion. This is also caused by hydrogen bonds. And cohesion is when similar substances stick together. Hydrogen bonds between polar molecules cause them to stick together. And this is how, for example, plants carry water from their roots all the way to the tops of their leaves. Also, the cohesion of water means the water molecules are holding on to each other, so some animals can actually walk on water, such as water striders. So again, cohesion is why plants can suck water up from the roots to their leaves, and why water striders can walk on water, like in this little video. Now, adhesion is when you add something else to the water. It's not cohesion, it's adhesion. And adhesion is caused by polarity. Now, because of the polarity of water, anything else that is polar will stick to water too. For example, water will stick to walls and cloths and the xylem in plants, and that's all because of its polarity. This is one of the reasons why, again, plants can suck water up the trees, because there's cohesion between the water molecules. So when you're sucking water from the top, it pulls from the bottom. And there's adhesion between water and the wood. So the water actually holds on and doesn't fall down against gravity. Basically how a straw works too. Now, this adhesion explains why water can dissolve things. A solvent is a liquid that dissolves substances. And because water is polar, it can dissolve all other polar particles. And some it's by forming hydrogen bonds, other ones it's really just polarity. So for example, water can dissolve proteins, sugars, and other mineral ions. So if you're ever worried, polar can dissolve in water, and there's a polar bear. Now, because you can dissolve so many things in water, the cytoplasm of your cells, which are mostly made of water, can hold a lot of things. And a lot of the proteins, like enzymes, can actually be dissolved in the water of your cell cytoplasms. So, water makes a great medium for your metabolism, a great place for metabolism to happen. It also makes a great transport medium, a place for transport to happen. Because if you dissolve sugar in water, say in your stomach, in your blood, and then move it to your muscles where you use it, the sugar in the water will move with the blood, move with the water. So here's a quick video talking about bonding in water.
Water itself is essential for life on Earth. 3/4 of our world is covered in water. It is thought that life originated in the water, and today all life requires water more than any other substance. But why is that? Let's take a look at the human body to answer that question. The body is made up of millions and millions of individual cells. Those cells are organized into tissues, and those tissues form our organs. All of our organs are then organized and form our body. Surrounding and filling each cell is water. The water helps to maintain cellular shape and also participates in most chemical reactions that are necessary to sustain life. Without water, our cells couldn't function and life really wouldn't be possible. The universal necessity of water is a result of its unique qualities. Those qualities result from its structure and the interaction between individual water molecules. A single water molecule is made up of one oxygen and two hydrogens, and they are arranged in the shape of a V, as shown here. The hydrogens are covalently bonded to the oxygen, which means they share a pair of electrons between them. There is a principle involved in chemical bonding called electronegativity. This is a chemical property that describes the tendency of an atom to attract electrons, or electron density, toward itself. The more electronegative an atom is, the more it attracts electrons toward it. In the case of water, the oxygen is more electronegative than the hydrogens, and as a result, it pulls the electrons toward it, and the electrons spend more time around the oxygen than they do around the hydrogens. This causes a partial negative charge to build up around one side of the oxygen, and where the hydrogens are, there's a buildup of a partial positive charge. This results in what we call a polar molecule, which means that, like a magnet, the two ends of the water molecule have opposite charges. The way that water molecules interact together is a result of this polarity. The partially positive hydrogen of one molecule and the partially negative oxygen of another molecule are attracted to each other and form a bond between one another. This type of bond is referred to as a hydrogen bond. In a liquid form, the hydrogen bonds between water molecules are considered very weak. They are constantly forming and breaking, each lasting only a few trillionths of a second. But since new bonds are always forming, at any instant there are a large percentage of molecules bonded to one another.
Now, let's go over a few more specific things. Water is used as a coolant in sweat. So I spoke about this already. High temperatures are potentially life-threatening to humans. We can die of overheating, and it causes our enzymes to stop working. Messes up with our homeostasis. Water absorbs a lot of energy before changing temperature. It's hard to change the temperature of water thanks to its hydrogen bonds. So, when water absorbs the energy, some of those water molecules will start moving faster and faster and faster until they can break the hydrogen bonds and turn into a gas. When your body releases water onto your skin as you sweat, heat will move from your blood vessels and your body to the water on your skin. Those molecules will absorb the heat and move faster until they evaporate. Now the hottest molecules have left first, cooling you down. So your blood is now cooler and can go back to your organs. Remember, the fastest molecules leave first. Those are the hottest ones. So the ones left behind are cooler. Now, the polarity of water, as I mentioned, makes it a great way to transport things around your body. Your blood is 95% water. The other 5% is the stuff dissolved in it, and water can dissolve anything that is small or polar. So, for example, glucose is water-soluble. That means that you can dissolve the glucose in water. Salts are also water-soluble. So you can dissolve Na and Cl in water. This is because both glucose and salts are polar. Next, amino acids, what proteins are made of, are small and soluble in water because they are polar. So again, your blood can move them around and your cytoplasm can have them. Some amino acids are a bit too big or maybe have non-polar sections, but generally speaking, you can think of amino acids as polar. And thus soluble. Now, oxygen, technically, oxygen gas is non-polar, but it's so small that it can actually fit between the spaces of water molecules and dissolve in water. That said, an enzyme or protein called hemoglobin helps carry even more oxygen in your red blood cells. So we'll talk more about hemoglobin later, but that's a good one to know. Now, fats are large and non-polar, so they cannot be dissolved in water. Instead, they're carried in little bags called lipoprotein complexes. And the fats go inside, and the outside of these bags are polar, so that they can go in water. Cholesterol is the same way. It's mostly nonpolar, so it's carried inside these lipoprotein complexes as well. That's the fancy word for these bags. And lipoprotein complexes have hydrophilic polar heads facing out, hydrophobic tails on the inside. So the outside is attracted to water. Attracted to water, polar on the outside, nonpolar on the inside. So last thing, substances can be hydrophilic or hydrophobic. Hydrophilic means attracted to water, basically polar. Hydrophobic is nonpolar, scared of water. And this tends to segregate from water by itself, like oils. There's actually one last thing I forgot. That was the last thing on transport. You need to be able to compare methane and water and their thermal properties. Methane is a fuel. It's in the atmosphere as a gas, and it's made by prokaryotes in a special type of anaerobic cell respiration. That said, this is the table you need to know. Methane is nonpolar, while water is polar. It's easy to change the temperature of methane, while it's hard to change the temperature of water. It's easy to evaporate methane, but hard to evaporate water. Methane has a low boiling point and a low melting point, while water has high ones. You need to know this. Here's another table saying the same thing. And again, nonpolar versus polar is why those thermal properties are so different. So, we're done with 2.2. Thanks for watching, and have a great rest of your day. Ciao!